What is Smoot'ems doing on a web broadcast? This came about from the strong interest of Gary Eckmeyer and Dick Stroud, who are members and who wanted not to miss a meeting. I saw the possibility for a larger audience for the club, a way to have a bigger club of others like ourselves, perhaps bring new energy into the club from the outside, find others like ourselves in isolated areas that have not found a club, rekindle our audio interests, and perhaps in the future a worldwide audio club. So I had to find out how to broadcast Smoot'ems. First thing is, we didn't change the agenda. It is the same meeting we've always had. It's the same agenda exactly. They look unchanged except for where I say take a break here. There's two parts to the meeting. One in the beginning where I chair the meeting. It's a loose parallel to the Tonight Show monologue. And then the second part is reviews and presentations, which are usually not me. Today it is me, but ladies of the Tonight Show guests. The club executives only supported me to the extent of permitting a broadcast. I was on my own for methods and money. No one expressed any interest in how the production would be done. No one participated in the research that I did to make the broadcast possible, and so that's what this review is in part about. Basic requirements for having the club on the web was to communicate clearly the words said at the meeting, the fun of a meeting, communicate the content of the PowerPoint or other presentation materials, communicate a visual sense of the meeting, not interfere with the normal progress of a meeting, and not compete with the meeting itself. That is, attending in person should be preferable to watching the broadcast. But still draw an audience from the world. Minimal crew seemed like a good idea. I didn't really think anybody was interested in being a crew member. It also would avoid the distraction of crew activities. There's also, I thought there should be minimal pre- and post-production work. That is, you know, does anybody really want to be the post-producer of such a program? Then there's the question of how to get it onto the web. Ustream or YouTube? YouTube accepts virtually any video upload. It is free. It is always a recording for later playback. There is a 15-minute time limit for the free uploads, but I think there are ways around that if it had other charm. YouTube picture is usually much, much higher quality than what we're getting on Ustream. That's the data rate is four times higher, roughly speaking, but it does require post-production and long, long upload times. Ustream is a real-time broadcast. It's free. The Ustream upload stream has to be kept slower than the limit of the connection to the internet that we have locally, and we have to make a quality compromise to keep below that limit. The speeds available on Ustream, there are five of them. The lowest quality gives a picture that's 352 by 198, 20 frames per second, with AAC 32 kilohertz mono sound. This results in a data rate of 200 kilobits per second. They will allow you to up that to 350 kilobits per second, with all the same specs, so they're promising less data reduction if you can assure yourself you can upload faster. What they call standard quality is the same frame size but at 30 frames per second with AAC 44.1 kilohertz stereo. This takes 350 kilobits per second. High quality, the picture gets larger, 720 by 405 at 30 frames per second, again with the 44.1 stereo. At 500 kilobits per second or 600 kilobits per second for the best quality. Your typical home internet connection, we have 300 kilobits per second available. This means we run at lowest quality. Stereo sound is not available until we reach 350 kilobits per second, which is over 20% faster than your basic home DSL. Good picture with stereo sound requires over 500 kilobits a second. So there's a real disadvantage in Ustream by the quality numbers, but better quality requires finding a service, an internet service, that would offer us high upload speed for each location, each host location, on the required dates. I haven't looked into that. It might be a possibility. With Ustream, there's no post-production required at all. We broadcast it. It is stored at Ustream, and the meeting just happens. When the broadcast ends, the production work ends. All that's left to do is pack the equipment. On presentations, the presenters wanted control. They wanted a smoother presentation. They wanted to have a freedom of location in terms of where they did their presentation from. And they wanted not to have to look over their shoulder at the screen, which is what I've been doing today. So we introduced in November Ustream Desktop Presenter. This is a program installed on the presenter's computer, which we set up before the meeting. The talker then selects the screen that's going to be relayed by Desktop Presenter over the network to my computer, and I select Desktop Presenter or one of the cameras to choose which is going to the web. The talker runs his PowerPoint normally on his screen of choice from his location of choice. The presenter and the broadcaster are really completely separate. Journal reviewers are invited to use this feature. You bring your PC, but we have to set it up before the meeting. Next is the video tour. And this, I'm going to try to show everything that's being used to broadcast this meeting. And to do that, I'm going to first take the camera at the back of the room, and then grab Ustream Producer and bring it over onto the projection screen so that now you can see what I've been looking at and how I've been working this. Get my cursor back here. These other things out of the way. Now you're looking at Ustream Producer. And next, I'm going to pick up the camera behind me. And you're seeing what's going out over the web. And I need my script again. And I need this cable to follow me. Okay, in 2005, I purchased this camera, 16x9 Firewire output. It is a Sony HDR FX1. And the second camera, which is now at the back of the room, which I'm supposed to use the manual zoom to get to it. This camera is nearly identical. The one I'm holding is nearly identical to the one at the back of the room. That one I picked up on eBay recently. It is the professional version. It's identical picture quality, aspect ratio, digital interface. It has better audio inputs than the one I'm holding in my hand. The main audio mixer output is connected to the line input of the camera at the back of the room. So the audio is then sent over the FireWire to the broadcast computer. The camera includes an automatic level control for the audio, and the mixer output is always set high so that the camera is always reducing the gain. The microphones are Behringer ECM 8000s. There's two in the seating area for the spontaneous comments, and this one at the front for the guest chairs. There is one microphone on my desk as for my own voice when I'm talking. This is an Astatic crystal microphone from 1941. It responds pretty well from 70 Hertz to 7 kilohertz, plus it has output at 10 kilohertz. There's a chasm in between 7K and 10K. It has an extremely high impedance output, and as such ought to be connected to a vacuum tube preamplifier, which we have a vacuum tube preamplifier. Way down the bottom of my desk is a Heathkit WAP2. The tone controls on the preamp are set to equalize the microphone. It has some bass boost and some treble cut to make a pretty smooth response over the range where it's effective. And then there is an audio mixer. I'm going to have to maneuver myself so that everybody can see the mixer. I'm going to read some of the promotional material on this piece so that you'll get a full spirit for what it does. It's a Behringer Xenix 1204 USB. It has four state-of-the-art phantom-powered Xenix mic preamps, comparable to standalone boutique preamps. Four studio-grade compressors with super easy one-knob functionality and control LED. Neoclassic British three-band EQs for warm musical sound. The settings I'm using are, each mic input has a 75 Hertz high pass filter. Those are all engaged, so we aren't transmitting rumbles. The mid-range control is at 2.5 kilohertz. It is set plus at 2 o'clock, so we're getting an intelligibility enhancement at that with the tone controls.
You turned that high pass off, I presume, while we were listening to Klaus's system?
Yes. And the flash video contained the low bass. I played it back on a subwoofer and it really was there. The compressor knob is set to 2 o'clock and the light is flashing on my voice. The whole audio system that I have here is stereo capable, but it is not currently used because of that data rate consideration. The computer to the internet is a HP DV62190 US. It's running Ustream Producer Pro, which you can see on the main screen there. The presenter's computer run Ustream Desktop Presenter connected on the wireless network to my computer. The router is a D-Link Extreme N gigabit router. DIR 655, that's connected to Ray's cable modem and sending us out over the internet.
Now there's no Ustream image visible on your computer, is that correct?
I have moved the Ustream producer up to the big screen. And now I'm going to, you can see my mouse finger, I'm going to take the picture. Where did my mouse go? From the other camera, put this camera back where it was,
so can you get those two cameras close enough together to make 3D?
Yes. I don't know how people are going to watch it. If it's normally as you'd see it, and let's see, we can do that. That would sort of be like you take this feature where we get both cameras going out over the web, and if the cameras were sitting next to each other, we would have a 3D image, but now you have to have a partition and perhaps some prisms to make those images in the right space.
If people were to train their eyes correctly, it's possible to see perfectly good 3D without any from...
I have tried this with this exact system that Dave just suggested.
Mm-hmm.
I had real trouble getting my eyes to do it.
Well, there are two ways of doing it. There's the wide-eyed and the cross-eyed.
Yes.
The cross-eyed, for most people, is much easier
yes.
than the wide-eyed.
I can do that there. I can switch it as simply as that.
Yep. And that. So that's really all you need.
Yeah. So it is possible. We could do a meeting in 3D, but we'd have to know how our viewers are going to watch it.
No, we just tell them, learn to do cross-eyed. Done with it. We've learned how to read schematics. Why not learn how to do
I have found 3D pictures on the web that I can do cross-eyed. I can't do that.
With these?
On this. On my 17-inch monitor, I can't cross my eyes far enough. I was able to see 3D from the viewfinders of these two cameras. When they're close together and the viewfinders are there, I can, and the viewfinders are tucked up on top of the handles, which they will do,
yeah.
I was able to put my face down in there and see the 3D on the viewfinders.
It's largely a matter of training. I didn't used to be able to do wide-eyed at all, and I've been practicing the last few months.
I tried a bit.
Wide-eyed pretty well now.
At the distance that this requires on a 17-inch monitor, I couldn't even come close. I mean, I could see my eyes almost getting there and just, oh, it hurt, and, you know, I couldn't do it.
I can fuse those into a single image right in the middle, even though they're of different things. So 3D is rather just like a plate of scrambled eggs.
Right.
Yeah, well, the angle subtended is small. Yes. It's when you're trying to do it at your full-size monitor, you want a decent image size and so on.
What Clark is pointing out is that your brain doesn't care if it's a 3D image or scrambled eggs. It'll fuse them and make something out of them.
Well, what I'm pointing out is from that distance, he doesn't have to move his eyes very far.
Right.
On a bigger screen, that's tougher. But a prism device would work.
Sure.
Okay. That's good. I'm glad somebody made something interesting out of this. The script girl should be collecting these now. The main... Shall we go back to regular, or do you guys like watching it this way? There. That's me, except I can't see me.
It'd be nice if it was the whole screen.
Yeah, I don't have a way to do that. So the main requirements of getting SMWTMS on the web have been met. We have good quality audio, communicates the words, and some words that people don't want to hear are broadcast as well. The two camera views get some of the fun in the visual sense of the meeting. We are limited in resolution by the upload speed.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.